So in the last section, we talked about scales and the notes that we need to create these scales in quite an abstract theoretical way. Now's a good time to actually go back and relate this to music in more general terms. So if we had a piece of music that just used the notes of C major, it's the notes of the C major scale, we could say that this music is in the key of C major.
And if we had the notes of the G major scale, with that F sharp, we can say this is in the key of G major.
So what do we actually mean by key? Well, it's quite a complex term really, and it relates not only to the notes that are available to us as drawn from the scale, but also to the way that we subconsciously hear the way that these notes work with each other and react with each other and the relationship that exists between each of these notes.
So that feeling in G major, we have a sense that out of all these notes, G is got a kind of gravity for us. G pulls us home. G is our tonic.
Yeah, we could say that when we're playing a piece of music that uses these notes, when we arrive back at G, there's a feeling of completeness or that we're at rest. It's the home note, if you like. So when we are talking about scales and keys, they are sometimes confused as terms. And what we really mean when we're talking about scales is this ordered string of notes. And when we're talking about key, just to reiterate, it is this relationship and the feeling that pulls us back to the tonic when we feel at rest.
Okay, so if you did the exercise that we used in the last section where we started on D, you'll know that we've got, in D major, we've got an F sharp and a C sharp. So if we were looking at a piece of music written down in a score, how would we know what key it's in? What we might want to do is look to see whether any of the Fs are sharpened, and we see, yes, all the Fs have got a sharp next to them. And we see that, oh, also, all the Cs have got a sharp next to them. In the context of everything we've just said so far in this lecture, it would make a lot of sense to say, oh, this piece of music's probably in D major.
So given that we know in this case that we're going to have every F sharp and every C as sharp, it might make sense for us to know this information up front, right at the start. And the convention that we've got for this, we call key signatures. So by announcing what we're going to have in terms of sharps or flats right at the very start, it does a couple of things for us. So firstly, from a musical point of view, what it does is it gives us an indication of where the tonic is, what's going to be most important, and also the relationship that exists between the notes in this key. But also, just from a visual point of view, what it does is it really tidies things up. So no longer do we have the need for every F and every C to have a sharp in front of it to say that these are going to be F and C sharp. Actually, we say this at the very start by means of the key signature, and we take it as read throughout unless we're signalled otherwise.
There's additional material on the website that'll help you learn more about the conventions of notation, because what we're talking about here is the idea of graphically representing for people to read and to write with all of these concepts and terms that we're introducing to you from music theory.
So key signatures are used to tell whoever's looking at the music what key the music's in. And they do so by signalling which notes are going to be sharp and which notes are going to be flat from the outset. Now, there's a really logical way for writing key signatures and also for looking at a key signature and determining what key it signifies.
We call this the circle, or sometimes the cycle, of fifths. Let's start with C. C, as we know, C major, is signified by having no sharps and no flats. That's the key signature. G, however, contains one sharp.
F sharp.
F sharp.
G.
And D has got two sharps. It's also got an F sharp, and now it's also got a C sharp on top.
So if we look at the circle of fifths, we can see when we look at the key signature for C that there are no sharps or flats. And this makes sense because when we play C major, when we're looking at it on the piano, we only use the white notes. If we look at the next stage round clockwise, we see that we're looking at G major, which is signified by having an F sharp. If we look at the next stage again, clockwise, we see that we've got D major, and this has an F sharp and a C sharp.
So you'll notice that the cycle of fifths is proceeding in literally stages of a fifth. C, D, E, F, G.
And then we've got G, A, B, C, D.
Each stage includes five note names forwards, and each stage includes one additional sharp as we go around the circle. Okay, so we've looked at our circle, the circle of fifths, moving round clockwise, where each stage takes us on five notes further forward. Okay, what happens if we look anti-clockwise? The result of this is that we're in fact moving in fourths instead of fifths. So we're starting at C again.
So let's start at C and move around the fourth. So if we go from C, we go to the fourth note of C major. C, D, E, F. So we're going to start on F. Now just to illustrate this really, let's apply the major scale pattern to F, okay? When we do that, we get F, G, A, B flat, C, D, E, F. So what we can say now is that the scale of F has a B flat in it, one flat.
One flat, one B flat. Clockwise, sharps, anti-clockwise, the first thing we notice is that we're introducing one flat. Okay, so we might be able to guess where this is going. Starting from the F, let's travel another fourth around the circle. So we're going anti-clockwise.
F, G, A, B flat.
B flat.
So we can take our B flat as the tonic now, and we're going to apply our major scale pattern. We've got B flat, C, D, then a semitone takes us to E flat, F, G, A, and back to B flat. So what we found now is that we've got a B flat and an E flat, so we've added an extra flat for an extra step round the circle, just as we did with sharps. Therefore, B flat has B flat and E flat. So it's all fair and well then, when we're looking at the circle of fifths, to say when we move round clockwise, we're going to add one extra sharp. Or when we move anti-clockwise, for each step, we're going to add one extra flat. But it's not really enough information. We need to know which extra sharps and which extra flats we're going to add for each step. So we could really go back to the keyboard and we could work it out from first principles. And for each new tonic, we build a major scale and we work out which extra sharps we've got and which extra flats we've got. But that's time consuming, it's a bit of a pain. We need to remember lots of different information. Actually, having some sort of mnemonic device for the order that sharps and flats occur is probably going to be quite useful. And it's really common for people to learn it in this way. So, a good mnemonic device for the order that the sharps would occur. Father, Christmas, gave Dad an electric blanket.
So, that's F, C, G, D, A, E, B.
We could also say Father Charles goes down and ends battle. It's a very common one to hear people talking about.
Okay, so there's two. You could make your own up. Now, this being the circle of fifths with all the patterns inherent in that, when we go anti-clockwise and we start introducing flats, you might not be that surprised to find out that the order in which flats occur is actually the same sequence as the sharps, but in reverse. B, E, A, D, G, E, C, G, C, F. So two sentences that we could use to try and remember that sequence.
Well, we've got blanket explodes and Dad gets cold feet, which is the reverse of the Father Christmas one.
Or battle ends and down goes Charles' father. So we now know that if you see a key signature at the start of a piece of music and it's got four sharps in it, those four sharps have to be F, C, G, and D. And we know that if you see a key signature with three flats in it, they're going to have to be B, E, and A.
So we've been talking about sharps and flats within keys. So that's to say that we've been talking about the sharps that belong to a particular key, or the flats that belong to a particular key. But what happens if we want to use a note that's out with the pool of notes available to us in any given key. So say we were in G major and we wanted to use a B flat, for instance. We know that this isn't part of the key signature, but there's absolutely nothing wrong with using a B flat in the overall context of G major. If we do this, if we use a sharp or a flat in a place that we don't expect it based on the key signature, we call these accidentals. And as I say, it's absolutely fine to use these, we just need to be aware of some conventions surrounding them so that we can actually use them and talk about them accurately. Have a look at the example.
We can see that in this example, the music's got a key signature of one sharp, so we know it's got to be an F sharp, and we know that this signals G major. However, there are notes here that don't belong to the key. There are some accidentals. As we work from left to right, looking along the example, we can see that there's a sharp sign in front of the third note, meaning that this is a G sharp. And looking further along, we notice a flat in front of the B, making it a B flat. Now, just in front of the next B, we see a symbol that we haven't seen before. This is another type of accidental, and we call it a natural. Its purpose is to cancel out the sharps or flats that have just previously been shown.
One thing that we need to mention at this point is that when an accidental is used, it's actually effective for the whole bar. We'll discuss what bars mean more next week, but really what we mean is until we see the next vertical line across the stave. So in the second bar, we see a B flat, and this means that any other B in that bar is also a flat. The natural sign in front of the last note in this bar actually cancels out the flat, meaning that this particular note is to be played as a B natural. That's to say, it's no longer a B flat. And again, although this is the last note in the bar, this instruction lasts right to the end of the bar. If we look at the next bar, we see a natural in front of the F. Again, this cancels out the F sharp in the key signature, and it means that this note is to be played as an F natural, not an F sharp.
Have a look at the additional material on the website. We've included some practice questions to help you get to grips with this.